48 hours ago, Microsoft Research released a paper describing a new language model for code called Phi-1. Despite using few parameters and little training data by modern standards, Phi-1 gets very strong results. In this video, I'll describe the key findings of the paper and explain why, together with the Orca work from Microsoft, this research could represent a step change in the cost of training large language models, with significant implications for the machine learning ecosystem. But first, let's take a step back. To get a handle on Phi-1, we need to understand the journey of large language models so far. It helps to begin by looking at what the community has learned over the last few years. Perhaps the best known empirical result has been the so-called scaling laws finding that performance improves somewhat predictably as one scales up either the amount of compute or the size of the network. In this work, the authors explore a different axis, the quality of the data. They draw inspiration from the recent Tiny Stories research on small-scale synthetic data that highlighted the importance of data quality. The goal of this work is to show that high-quality data can even improve the state-of-the-art of large language models while dramatically reducing the dataset size and training compute. This is a result that can significantly reduce the environmental cost of LLMs, as noted by the authors. I think it may also have big implications for the ability of teams with fewer resources to build powerful models. The headline results in this paper are reported on HumanEval, which is a dataset of handwritten problems curated by OpenAI as part of their Codex work, and the Mostly Basic Python Programs benchmark of entry-level Python programs introduced by Google. A few things jump out. First, Phi-1 gets very strong results, 50.6% on HumanEval, the most widely reported benchmark. Only WizardCoder and GPT-4 score higher in this table, and Phi-1 outperforms WizardCoder on MBPP. The second is the scale. While WizardCoder has 16 billion parameters and a trillion tokens of training data, Phi-1 is just 1.3 billion parameters and is trained on 7 billion tokens. Of course, GPT-4 is playing its cards close to its chest. How are these Phi-1 results possible? What is the magic ingredient? The answer, according to the authors, is very much the data quality. They say that, roughly speaking, we pre-train on textbook quality data, both synthetically generated with GPT 3.5 and filtered from web sources, and we fine-tune on textbook exercise-like data. Despite being several orders of magnitude smaller than competing models, both in terms of dataset and model size, Phi-1 performs very well. Let's turn to training details and the importance of high-quality data. Looking at existing code collections like the stack, gathered as part of the Big Code project, the authors argue that these sources are not optimal for teaching the model how to reason and plan algorithmically. Based on manual inspection of random samples, the authors observe that many of the snippets in existing datasets are not very instructive for learning the basics of coding and suffer from several drawbacks. The samples are not self-contained, consist of trivial or boilerplate code, are often buried inside complex or poorly documented functions, making them difficult to follow or learn from, and are skewed towards certain topics or use cases, resulting in an unbalanced distribution of coding concepts. I particularly like this line. One can only imagine how frustrating and inefficient it would be for a human learner to try to acquire coding skills from these datasets, as they would have to deal with a lot of noise, ambiguity, and incompleteness in the data. Indeed, the authors then conjecture that language models would benefit from a training set that has the same qualities as what a human would perceive as a good textbook. It should be clear, self-contained, instructive, and balanced. The training relies on three main datasets: a filtered code language dataset, which is a subset of the stack and stack overflow, obtained by using a language model-based classifier consisting of about 6 billion tokens, a synthetic textbook dataset consisting of less than a billion tokens of GPT 3.5 generated Python textbooks. Wait, what? A billion generated tokens? Last, a small synthetic exercises dataset consisting of 180 million tokens of Python exercises and solutions. How useful is this data? What you can see here is that in each scenario, either 350 million parameters or 1.3 billion parameters, moving from the stack to code textbook brings a gain, and fine-tuning on code exercises brings a further major boost. Of course, this is very much fine-tuning for the target distribution of solving programming exercises, so it doesn't necessarily immediately follow from this result that the model will also be better as a coding assistant, but still, the result is quite striking. I find the filtering process to be quite interesting. The authors start from the Python subset of the deduplicated version of the stack and the stack overflow datasets. They then annotate the quality of a small subset of these files, about 100,000 samples, using GPT-4. Given a code snippet, the model is prompted to determine its educational value for a student whose goal is to learn basic coding concepts. After this, they use this annotated dataset to train a random forest classifier that predicts the quality of a file or sample using its output embedding from a pre-trained CodeGen model as features. They make the point that they are using GPT-4 minimally only for annotations on the quality of a small subset of the stack and stack overflow samples, rather than as a core part of the synthetic pipeline. Here, you can find snippets scored as high educational value and low educational value. On the left, we have small functions with descriptive titles and doc strings. The model can even learn the magical value of epsilon, which clearly here has been ordained by the gods to be 10 to the minus 12. On the right, we have a bunch of attributes being set, which is presumably significantly harder for the model to learn from. Next, we move on to the creation of synthetic textbook quality datasets. It's clear that we want diverse data, but this isn't easy, because simply prompting the model to produce a coding textbook or set of exercises, even with some variation in the instructions or the parameters, will likely result in a very homogeneous and redundant dataset. So, one needs to find the right trick that will induce the language model to be more creative and diverse in its output, while still maintaining the quality and the coherence of the examples. The first part of their data is the synthetic textbook dataset of less than 1 billion tokens of GPT-3.5 generated Python textbooks, synthesized to provide a high-quality source of natural language-heavy text interleaved with relevant code snippets. The authors say that diversity is obtained by providing constraints on the topics and target audience of the generated textbook. Here's an example. First, we have a short paragraph defining singular matrices. Then, we have an example matrix together with an explanation for how we can determine whether it's singular. Then we get a Python implementation of the function, and finally an example usage together with a comment communicating the expected output. Next, we have the code exercises dataset, a small synthetic exercises dataset consisting of less than 180 million tokens of Python exercises and solutions, where each exercise is a doc string of a function that needs to be completed. Given its close proximity to the testing distribution, the authors conduct explicit decontamination and alternative evaluations to ensure that problems similar to those from the HumanEval benchmark are not seen during fine-tuning. Here's an example where the task is to make a list of valid guessing letters that are present in a word, with a doc string and a solution. The model architecture and training are fairly standard, effectively following CodeGen, with a few modifications, like using the flash attention implementation of multi-head attention. They train on 8 NVIDIA A100 GPUs for not very long. The pre-trained base model, Phi-1 Base, was obtained in under 4 days of training. Fine-tuning to obtain Phi-1 used an additional 7 hours on the same hardware. Let's think about what it has taken to produce a model with very competitive performance on Python coding benchmarks. First, a billion tokens of GPT-3.5. for the synthetic textbook dataset. Looking at pricing, this costs $0.002 per 1,000 output tokens, and we probably also need a few input tokens, perhaps a tenth as many, which costs $0.0015 per 1,000 tokens. Next, for the code exercises dataset, we need another 180 million tokens of Python, again generated with GPT-3.5, so we can estimate cost with the same pricing scheme. Next, we have the cost of annotation with GPT-4. Assuming these samples are representative, and they have about 100 tokens each, GPT-4 will have processed a little more than 10 million input tokens, and perhaps 1 million output tokens, if there are 10 tokens in each answer. The cost here is $0.06 per 1,000 input tokens, and $0.12 per 1,000 output tokens if we gratuitously use the GPT-4 model with the largest context. Let's assume you pay for your GPUs on the most expensive AWS setup using on-demand pricing. That's $31.218 per hour, and we'll need this for 4 days and 7 hours, or 103 hours. Last, we need to estimate the price of getting a cappuccino in Redmond while waiting for OpenAI to generate the tokens. We have a lot of options here. We'll take a grande, $5.65. We can throw all this into a spreadsheet, and we find that the compute and cappuccino budget for this entire project probably cost a little under $6,500. That's less than two Apple Vision Pros. A bargain. This is, in relative terms, what you might describe as an affordable model. The last experiments consider a more aggressive form of data pruning to provide more evidence that Phi 1 is not just good because it sees training examples that look like the test set. Here they find that even after heavily pruning the dataset, Phi 1 still outperforms star coder prompted by a large margin, which validates that the performance boost is not due to dataset contamination, even when the latter term is understood loosely. However, it is clear from their analysis that all models perform better on test problems that are similar to those generated by GPT 3.5 relative to those that are non-similar. We can see that in the Phi-1 model, in the pruned model, and in StarCoder prompted. Let's wrap things up. The key takeaway here is that by crafting textbook quality data, the authors were able to train a model that surpasses almost all open source models on coding benchmarks such as HumanEval and MBPP, despite being 10 times smaller in model size and 100 times smaller in dataset size. I think this has significant implications for training efficiency. It's hard to know how quickly this will affect the commercial ecosystem. The OpenAI terms of use explicitly forbid using output from the services to develop models that compete with OpenAI. But it may be open to interpretation how broadly the term compete applies. And these terms may not be true of other providers. One for the lawyers, I suspect. The authors note some limitations. Firstly, Phi-1 is specialized in Python coding, so it can't handle other languages yet. Second, it lacks the domain-specific knowledge of larger models, such as programming with specific APIs or using less common packages. And lastly, due to the lack of diversity in terms of language and style, Phi-1 is less robust to stylistic variations or errors in the prompt. For instance, its performance substantially degrades when there are grammatical mistakes in the prompt. Still, none of these limitations seem fundamental, and with more work, their approach could be used to tackle each one of them, although it is unclear what scaling might be necessary to overcome them, both for the model size and the dataset size. The authors also believe that significant gains could be achieved by using GPT-4 to generate the synthetic data instead of GPT 3.5, since they notice that GPT 3.5 data has a high error rate. Perhaps most interestingly, Phi-1 is able to achieve high coding proficiency despite those errors. A similar phenomenon was observed in prior work on the physics of language models, where a language model could be trained on data with 100% error rate and still generate correct answers at test time. This appears to reflect the long-standing observation that students can outperform teachers in many distillation settings. The authors conclude by saying that as language models themselves will be used to curate data for future language models, it further increases the urgency on the ethical and social implications of training such models, such as the accountability, the transparency, and the bias of the data and the models that are involved in this process. That's it, we've reached the end. Though it's early days, my preliminary judgment is that this preprint, taken together with Orca, will be pointed to as a significant transition point in how efficiently large language models can be trained. Reducing costs by several orders of magnitude could be a very big deal. Thanks for watching. I hope you have a wonderful day.